There's been lots of conversation due to the fires across 2019-2020 summer in Australia about whether people should be allowed to build in areas that are so bushfire prone and be able to reconstruct their lives in areas that may be subjected to bushfires down the track. In this video, we talk more about that topic and what to consider in terms of planning and strategizing your project moving forward. This video is part of our Rebuild and Build Better series. So be sure to like the video, subscribe to Undercover Architect's YouTube channel, and hit the bell so that you're always notified when a new video is published. In this video, we talk about these high level understandings, what we need to do to actually think about planning on a greater sense in terms of our land subdivision, and how to ensure that we're helping people develop properties in areas that can support them being able to protect their properties, build well, and build better properties overall. Hello, I'm Amelia Lee from Undercover Architect, and I help and teach homeowners how to get it right when designing, building, and renovating their family homes. In this video, I speak with Jeff Dau from Ember Bushfire Consulting. Ember Bushfire Consulting are a team of qualified accredited professionals in the fire industry, and Jeff himself, as co-founder, has over 28 years experience as a professional in the fire industry. He shares a huge wealth of knowledge and information when it comes to understanding the impacts that a bushfire overlay can have on your property and how you need to navigate building and renovating in one of these types of areas.
Now, you do a lot of work with subdivisions and helping developers understand better, I suppose, subdivision strategies and those types of things in bushfire-prone areas. How can some of that work that you do help communities understand how to build better resilience around their holistic kind of performance in these types of situations?
So that's the good news again, how this bushfire protection is influencing the way that we plan. So bushfire protection very much is a planning issue. It's not a construction issue. If we're dealing with it at the construction side of things, then something's been missed. Just because you can build in flame zone doesn't mean that you should. And so that obviously clearly, and I'm on the side of Black Mountain here. My residence is probably about 40. Although it was built in the 60s, so there's no chance. So, you know, we're very much leave early. There's no hanging around here on a bad day. And so what our property looks like is we're backing straight onto reserve. There's no setback. There's no nothing. There's no level of protection at all. No construction, but no setback. So what we see particularly in Canberra and seeing in New South Wales is that when these in new suburbs, they have to, by legislation, they have to get assessed and designed to consider bushfire now, which is great. So largely we'll see lots of edge roads. Great. That's something that's never going to change. That's a beautiful thing in the APZ because it never really has to be managed. And then some along the easement, you'll have, you know, grassland and whatnot. A small pocket of grassland. So that's the first thing I'll say is that the suburbs have been designed that access, there'll be multiple points of access. So as a whole of community, they're much better. Water supplies, take into consideration, you know, historically the water supply has been to deal with structure fires, the fires within the structure. Now that it's actually looking at a bushfire or grass fire coming to the subdivision, these are now considered there as well. And then obviously the management and maintenance of these APZs, so that's going back to some sort of body corporate or whoever's running the subdivision now. So these areas are now managed on an ongoing basis. So that's how it's changing, which is great. So the ideal, the hope is in that in any new suburb, any new subdivision, you shouldn't have Bell 40 and flame zone properties because if it hasn't been, it shouldn't have been accepted at that DO level. And that's what RFS is. So that's a lot of my work is to make sure that there is no dwelling, no building envelope that is susceptible to, you know, is subject to a Bell 40 or flame zone rating. So hopefully we've got that right. And then 29 is a good build in terms of the cost. And material selection. So that's what I'd say in the plan, the planning space, even for a two-lot subdivision. So property owners got a large lot, they want to break it down into two lots. Even that new lot has to pass, you know, a test, and that's what we go in. We take in planning for bushfire protection, and we assess the access, we access, you know, where they want to build, and we'll direct them on that as well. So yeah, that's what's happening in the planning space, and that's where it all does need to happen. So
that sounds incredibly sensible in terms of an approach, like just let's be preventative about this
exactly.
and proactive, yeah, rather than us just willy-nilly subdividing and then letting the individual be the one who has to deal with the fallout of it. So
that's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah,
and that's a product of the 97-99 fires and before in New South Wales. They said, you know what, we need to change this. And in 2006, planning for bushfire protection came in. It looked at construction, looked at all those elements that we talked about. So I think we're getting it right. We are getting it right. And then, as I said, evidence is that the construction is getting better. So this need not be bad news. You know, it's actually, we've got some positive news there. So we're making some changes here. So,
Think that's it. Like it's been really interesting. I've had the benefit of talking with people that were very closely involved in the recovery after the Victoria 2009 fires, and then seeing them being called in to help with this recovery effort now, and the body of knowledge and experience being able to add to, I suppose, how people recover, how areas are going to recover, and what actually is going to be a better strategy moving forward. There was a bit of criticism with the 2009 fires that people were just pushed. There was an urgency to rebuild and to try and get people kind of back to normalcy as soon as they could possibly be. And so people were, I think, rebuilding. They were seen to be rebuilding potentially too soon for when they were ready. And, you know, and so I think it's really encouraging to see that where there's a different approach happening this time, and it's also being led by a different learning process that's happened in between these different, you know, these 2003, 2009 fires, and what that might mean for planning moving forward, because we're, you know, particularly down the eastern seaboard of Australia, which is where, you know, everybody was shocked to see the spread of the fires down that eastern seaboard, but that's also one of the most densest areas for population in Australia, and the densest areas for subdivision and for growth over the next 20 years. So it's great to see that this is all informing that process in terms of a planning approach.
Yeah, it's coming together.
Now, there's been a conversation around should people even be allowed to rebuild in some of these areas. I know that a lot these areas that were affected, a lot of them are in your jurisdiction in terms of the areas that you service in your business. What's your thoughts around how you'll help clients who might be rebuilding after this kind of event to think about the strategies of rebuilding in these areas and whether it's a good decision in terms of what they do for their futures?
Yeah, it's a hard one, you know, and, you know, we've had stay and defend for a long time, ever since, you know, and that's I think this is largely what's led to, you know, a lot of fatalities and the like. Whereas in, say, United States, they get the National Guard in and they just evacuate everywhere. But you see massive property loss as well. There's been some really bad fires there in California, and you'll see whole subdivision is just gone. So it turns from a, you know, vegetation fire into this suburban conflagration, like it's just property to property to property. So it would be, the point is it would be a shame to lose that ability to stay or to you know, take that decision away. And so I think we're going to be holding on to that. What that means then for rebuilding is that I think, you know, largely we should be allowed to go back in, but because I think what is also happening is that now we've got this because of these changes, we've got this other consideration in the thought process, exactly what we've just been talking about. The structure is now more resilient. We've done all we can to improve the property. So I think that there's going to be, my point is that there's going to be less reliance on, you know, staying to defend. The people are going to go, you know what, I've done a lot and I've done everything that I could to prepare this property from, you know, from the outset when it was built. The APZs are good. I'm now much more comfortable to leave. So it would be a shame to just have this situation where people are forced to evacuate. And therefore, not allowed to build, But I think that we have this this other element in there that now that helps that only because we've got these new bushfire protection we've improved bushfire protection. I hope I've kind of answered that. I can't see it happening where people won't be allowed to build back in. So in summary, what has changed is that we're now perhaps more confident or positive that the structure, the home will survive. Therefore, that takes the pressure off on having to stay and defend, and they can leave and leave early. So therefore, they should be able to build. I hope that answered the question. I've sort of danced around there a bit. But,
it does.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think that's what's changed is we've got now a new consideration. You know, if you've built to about 29 and we've got the sprinkler system and we've got a really good APZ, you'll be, far less likely to stay. You're going to, you know what, I'm going to leave. And I reckon my house has got a good chance of surviving. So.
Yeah, I think what the interesting challenge or the most, I suppose, the most confronting challenge for people is going to be is that the cost of rebuilding and rebuilding to that standard and whether that makes it unaffordable for people. I know that there's been fires that were a year prior to the most recent ones where a lot of those areas had become Baal flame zone in the time, as legislation had been updated. And so the people that lost their homes that were in these areas that then need to be rebuilt as Baal flame zone and they're either uninsured or underinsured is the challenge then of that cost to rebuild. And it's that tricky balance, isn't it, between having strategies around rebuilding to a code level that actually gives you that resilience and performance around your property, but then also being able to fund it and have a continuing lifestyle with your family in that area. So there's a lot of puzzle pieces coming into play, but I think that you're right in terms of just saying to people a blanket, no, that place is no longer safe to live. You can't rebuild there is not the approach. And we do have the policies and the procedures in place to enable rebuilding. It's the affordability piece that might be the challenging one. So, yeah.
I was just going to say, encouraged by to see how many people are leaving. It would appear as though there are fewer and fewer people who are willing to stay because, of the lessons of the past, because of the O3s, the O9s, which had a huge, number of fatalities. So I think people are learning as well. They're just, you hear it on the TV when you certainly over the last summer, is that I'm just going. I've done what I can. I'm just going. So I think that is happening more, and that's a very good thing, and hopefully it does support this idea that we'll go back. We'll do what we can to the house and to the home, but the most important thing is life.
Did you find that helpful? I so hope that you did. Make sure that you check out the description below. We've got lots of extra information to help and support you as you build or renovate your home. There's also a full transcript available of this interview, and the link is in the descriptions below. Now, be sure to like the video, subscribe to Undercover Architect's YouTube channel, and hit the bell so that you're notified every time a new video is published. And you can be sure to check out these videos as well, because we've got lots of extra information to share with you that's going to be super helpful. As always, thank you for tuning in and for letting me be your secret ally. Until next time, bye.